So who's in a rugby team?
And how are they built up?
Let's burn through that.
My name's Dax.
My name's Nick.
And welcome to our Rugby Chat YouTube channel.
So this is the first preview show we're going to do. We're going to do these every week now. Usually they'll be out around Wednesday or Thursday. To give you guys an indication of what we think is going to happen in the coming weekend. In addition to that, because we could get through that in about 5 minutes, we're going to have a little segment about rugby in general. Yeah. This could be a little chat about something. Mm-hmm. It could be us explaining new rules. It could be us just answering questions that you may have in the comments section.
Yeah. For the next couple of weeks, we've talked about it. We're going to talk about the basics of rugby.
Yeah.
So this week, we're going to look at what players actually build up a rugby team. What are their positions? What are their functions within the game?
Yeah.
We'll probably look at other things on down the line, such as what are the referees' calls, what are the new rules or rule changes. We might actually explain definitions in terms of the terminology, but it's going to be a growing segment that will precede the preview segment of our chats.
So let's dive right into it. So we'll start off with what makes up a rugby team. Who are the people? What are their positions?
Yeah.
So basic premise is 15 people on a team. Mm-hmm. And we'll start with the basics. So unlike soccer, the numbers on the back of a player's jersey actually mean something.
Yeah.
Tells you what position they play very quickly and very easily. Yeah. Unlike soccer where you could
just
have
random.
Number 103 on the field.
Yeah. So the numbers and the positions correlate. So we have what we call forwards and backline players. The forwards are numbered 1 to 8 and your backline players are numbered 9 to 15.
So we'll start off basically with the forwards because we'll start at 1.
Yeah.
So number 1 and number 3 are called the props.
Yeah.
Now number 1 is a loose head prop and number 3 is a tight head prop. What does that mean? Well, in the scrum, you can imagine 3 on 3, there's always one that's loose and one that's tight, in the sense that their ears are covered on one side or both sides.
Yeah. So the loose head prop's head is on the outside of the scrum with the tight head actually slotting into that. Loose head prop is considered your right shoulder and your tight head is considered your left shoulder.
The next is number 2 is the hooker. And no, we're not talking about the person on the side of the road. This is the person in the scrum that literally, when this ball gets put into the scrum, hooks it backwards with their foot.
And he performs another important role where he actually throws the ball in to the lineouts.
Exactly. Now you have your locks. You got your 4 and your 5, your 2 locks. The 4 is the loose head lock and the 5 is the tight head lock.
Yeah, these are generally the tallest dudes on the park. They have to be because they're considered your line-out jumpers or your main line-out jumpers. Yes. And they basically stabilize the scrum behind the props.
Now traditionally your number 4 lock was your brute force guy. Just think of like Bucky Spurter, you know, like a big strong
enforcer.
And your number 5 was considered your smart lock.
Mm-hmm.
Who called the calls in the line-out to try and stump the other team, what jumpers jumping where. In the modern game, it's a bit fluid now.
Yeah, it's changed a little bit, yeah.
But that's essentially the basic roles, is they slot in behind the props and the hooker and the scrum, and then they are mostly the jumpers and the lineouts.
Yeah. And then you get two flanks. You get an open side flank and you get a blind side flank. Now, to discuss the terminology, open side means that if you're up against the touchline, your open side flank is the guy who can actually scan the open side of the park, with your blind side guy being the guy who defends the blind side attack.
Basically, as the game has evolved, also your number 6 flank has been termed what is known as a fetcher. He goes into the ruck, tries to steal the ball and run away with it, like a TV screen.
And then you get your number 7, who's considered your more brute force flanker. He's the general guy that you want to pass to, try and break the line. But the game's evolved where both of them kind of perform both the same function nowadays.
Then you get number 8 on the field, which is very originally named the 8th man.
He still is called the 8th man.
He's right at the back of the scrum. He looks after the ball at the back of the scrum, make sure it doesn't squirt out really quickly. He will occasionally pass off to the scrum half if they're doing an 8, 9, 10 play. And he's also an added flank.
He's basically a third flank. He's also basically the third lock as well, considering that most eighth men are considered as a third lock in the lineup jump. Also, they have a combined role in terms of basically being an enforcer in terms of taking the ball up or being a fetcher as well. Think of Dwayne Vermeulen from Toulon coming back to the Stormers. He's very strong at the ball. Or you have the other side of the spectrum with Warren Whiteley from the Lions, for example, who's very, very good at taking the ball up at speed, considered a very, very good third line-out jumper.
So that's basically the forwards in a nutshell. We could obviously talk about this for hours, but we don't have the time. So then we'll get into the background. So we're starting with number 9, which is also known as the scrum half. Or in New Zealand, what's it, the first 5-8 or something weird?
Like okay, we're not going to do the weird New Zealand terms. We probably will do that in terminology for you guys who are following the Super Rugby. But for now, we'll keep it very simple. A scrum half is basically what we will call the fulcrum player. He will be the person who feeds the ball into a scrum. And he's going to be the guy who actually takes the feed from the scrum and passes it to the back line or to the next player who's actually going to...
He's also the small guy on the field that's running from tackle to tackle to get the ball out of the base of the ruck and pass on. His essential role is to move the ball, pass it as quickly as possible to the fly-off. So number 10 is your general of the backline.
He's your pivot.
He's your pivot. He is in charge of where the ball goes, if it goes left or right, what moves they're doing, and he's generally what some people like to say the smartest player on the field.
Yeah,
it's debatable whether he is actually the smartest player on the field, but...
Your fly half's considered the pivot or the general in most terms. He's the guy who generally is supposed to get the first pass from the scrum half. It's not always the case because he would probably make the call to pass the forwards, bring it up, that type of thing. He's the more traditional fly half, also carries the responsibility of taking the penalty kicks in terms of kicking for touch if it's too far from the post for the opposition team, or being the guy who converts or scores the penalty. More traditional fly halves are also known to do drop goals from deep in the pocket, which you don't see much nowadays, but is still a primal function of a fly half, or generally a good fly half.
Yeah. Number 11 is your left wing. Now these are usually your fastest guys in the field, much like soccer. Their job is to run up the touchline and try and sneak past defenders. Yeah. That's basically their role in a nutshell. You traditionally want someone who's fast on their feet, but also very stable in defense because they often are your last line of defense. So if we're looking at New Zealand, they are very traditional in that they tend to have big wings that are fast and strong. Looking more South African, we tend to have smaller fast wings than your big guys.
Yeah, wings also will function as what we'll get to the position as outside fullbacks. They generally need to be very safe and secure under a high ball. They also need to be the type of guys who are always busy, always looking for work, considering that they're always on the outside of play. But they're generally extremely fast and quick, and they generally link up in general play.
Number 12 is your inside center. Now this guy is traditionally quite big, he's traditionally the guy who the fly-half gives the ball to and he runs straight at the defenders to try and break through. Now, in the modern game of rugby, this has evolved a bit to being like a second fly-half where he's got to have a good passing game to either decide if he is going to bash it up, if he's running the correct line, or am I going to pass this up towards the wings, or am I going to do some interesting play with the fly-half?
Yeah, so your inside center, you generally want to be you generally want to have a guy who's very smart in terms of how to see how the run of play is going. A lot of the time you would want your inside center to either make the decision to pick off a gap, straighten a line in terms of meaning if the back line's moving a little too laterally, you want him to be the guy who steps off on that outside foot and straightens the line towards the defenders, or set up a really, really good pass either inside to a wing who's linking up and play, or to your outside center who is our next player we're going to introduce.
Yeah, number 13, outside center. It's generally smaller in stature than the inside center, and he is the guy who runs through gaps. He doesn't run necessarily at the defense, so what you ideally like is your number 12 to run at the defense, draw players into him so that he can either do a quick little pop to the outside center, or the scrum half can just pick up quickly from the ruck, pass the outside center where there's a gap formed and he can just run through. He's normally quite fast, but he also is a little stockier than your average wing.
Yeah, generally your number 12s and 13s have to be defensively sound. You want these guys to have a really good tackle technique, not be the type of guys who are run over by our flankers or eighth men. He also needs to be very, very good at linking up players. So he has to be a very, very good communicator, letting our number 12 inside center know that he's coming in for the gap, or rather run it up, set up, so we can create something else.
Number 14 is a right wing, pretty much described what wings do, but 11 left, 14 right. That's essentially the difference.
Still a fast, quick player. New Zealand stocks are generally bigger. South Africans, smaller. Australians between the two, but...
It depends if they're stealing them from Fiji or not.
That's also true.
Okay. 15 is the fullback. Now, this player...
is essentially your back line fly half.
He is your last line of defense. He generally sits quite far back compared to everyone else. He needs to be good under the high ball. He needs to be good at the counter attack, because often he's getting the ball quite far back in, off a kick, and he needs to try get it up and gain some meters. Traditionally we prefer bigger guys who can tackle, because again, last line of defense. But recently, at least in the South African game, they tend to be a lot smaller and more agile on their feet to deliver the X factor, as some people call it.
Well, it worked for some franchises in New Zealand as well. I mean, Damien McKenzie is an example for the Chiefs, who's been a very dangerous fullback. And he's also smaller in stature. South Africans, not that much on the small side anymore. Basically, you would want your fullback to be your second fly half, basically, on the field, in terms of he's the guy who's going to, in the back, going to link the wings into the game as well. You'll also find that the fullback will sometimes come into the game instead of the inside center, just to create a bit of more variation in terms of keeping the defensive side honest. So fullback does have a lot of different roles, and he can also take penalty kicks, conversions, and also the kicks for touch.
So basically that's the rugby team in a nutshell. I mean, in later videos we will go on to who's on the bench and why they have to be on the bench, and how that can change in terms of strategy. We won't do that now, because we now have to quickly go into the previews and just get through those quickly. So starting off on Friday. We got the Highlanders versus the Stormers. Listen, let's be honest here, based on this weekend's performance against the Crusaders, Stormers aren't going to win.
No.
It's going to be Highlanders all the way.
I think the Highlanders are going to be too good. It's been a very brutal tour for the Stormers. The heartbreaking last minute loss against the Waratahs. The Crusaders creating a few injury problems in the Stormers lines as well. As much as I'd like to say, based on the Stormers never say die attitude that they've taken on and contesting right to the end, the Highlanders are going to be a little too much. I see minimum 7 points for the Highlanders, up to 14 points in terms of taking this game.
Rebels versus Brumbies. Rebels seem to be benefiting a lot from the axing of Western Force. They're getting some good players in. I mean, Will Guinier is their general in the back line at scrum half. He's a solid player. Brumbies, it seems like discipline cost them their loss against the Reds. Excuse me. I really think that it's going to cost them again, with Reds being at home, Brumbies having done a lot of playing so far.
Yeah.
I think Rebels are going to get this by 7.
Yeah. Rebels at home, I think they're going to probably be a little bit more grateful. They didn't have that far of a flight to face the Sunwolves this past weekend, so there's not going to be none of that jet lag issue. Rebels definitely have been the Australian team, surprisingly, this year. Coming off two really good wins up front, so I don't think that that's going to change much. Brumbies are going to be a difficult side to put away. I mean, they did show some really, really good signs against the Reds this past week, but I'd like to say that the Rebels will definitely take it by 7 points this week.
Hurricanes versus Crusaders. Hurricanes are coming off from a lot of travelling from New Zealand to South Africa, from South Africa to Argentina, and now back to New Zealand. I got to say, that's going to hit them.
Yeah. I think it is going to take a toll on them, especially the very narrow loss against the Bulls kind of, I think, would have deflated them. They did get some confidence back against the Jaguars, but slow start, costing them a little bit, a little bit of discipline issues, creeping into their game a little bit, but even though they are at home, the Crusaders coming off some really, really good wins up front. They're 2-2 at the present moment, some really, really good wins. They might struggle a little bit knowing that their number 10 possibly out with a broken jaw. So the general is probably not going to be there to control the game too well. But again, I don't think that the Crusaders are going to go backwards on this one. So we both agree, like 10 points minimum on this one.
Reds versus Bulls, this one required some debating. But my feelings are the Reds haven't shown us anything special on attack. They won their game against the Brumbies just by kicking over penalties.
Yeah.
And they lost fairly well to the Rebels. So.
Well, in terms of against the Brumbies, they were 2-0 Brumbies' favour. So Bulls, if they keep ball in hand, they control it, they get their forwards dominant, basically taking it to the Reds up front. I think in some ways, I agree the Bulls can take this one. Bulls have to get their heads into the game, though. Yes, they lost heavily to the Lions, but if they keep their discipline very well, get their defensive minds and defensive lines intact, I think that they can actually cause an upset to the Reds.
Yeah, and I mean, it just takes you to win one game on tour and you set yourself up fairly well for the season to come.
Yeah, so, and the Bulls have known to travel fairly well in the past, so especially against Australian sides, the Bulls have that history, so come on, Bulls.
Yeah, sort your shit out. Sharks versus Sunwolves, do we really need to debate this?
No, Sharks at home, Sunwolves travelling, Japan to KwaZulu-Natal, South Africa is a long way. Yeah, and again, they've come off some bruising battles in Japan. Sharks, if they get their handling issues sorted out, I don't think the Sunwolves are going to be in this contest at all.
Minimum 7 points.
Minimum 7 points for the Sharks if the Sunwolves are competitive enough. I mean, they have shown they're competitive against both the Brumbies and Rebels. Minor issues just creeping into the game, but I don't think the Sharks are going to lose this one.
Next game is the Lions versus the Blues. Now this one I think is a tough one to call. I mean, the Blues, even though they've lost both their games so far, they've lost by squeakers, where they literally could have won it right up to the last minute. And then you got the Lions, who are winning fairly well, but they haven't really tested themselves against New Zealand opposition yet.
The Blues at the present moment showing that they're an 80-minute team. I mean, the Blues, even though the losses have hurt, and I'm pretty sure that the Blues are working on those little things, they're an 80-minute team, and if they get out the gate straight off against the Lions, who generally, so far, have shown that they take a little bit of time to get into the game, I think if the Blues get out front, it's going to be very difficult for the Lions. However, if the Lions get the composure and they can do what they did with the Bulls and to the Jaguars, get some really, really good tries in, get some front football, it can go either way. I mean, it's going to be a 5-point swing either way. If the Blues get up front early and hold the Lions off, then by 5. If the Lions get off the game line from the start, going to give the Blues some issues, especially because the Lions at home, they can take it by 5 points as well.
Yeah. Yeah, Warriors versus Waratahs. Waratahs are traveling again. Fatigue, jet lag. It was quite a trip from South Africa to Argentina. Again, it comes down to discipline from the Jaguars. If they're not disciplined, Waratahs are going to take it away from them. They've got Bernard Foley's boot behind them.
And they've got Kirkley Beale.
They've got Kirkley Beale's boot as well.
And Folau, who's a great attacking player.
Yeah, and then you got Hooper, who's a great fetcher and flank.
Yeah.
So I think I'm going to give it to the Waratahs on this one, just because the skill set is probably a lot better than the Jaguars. But again, if fatigue happens, Jaguars could win it.
Yeah, again, the Waratahs, like the Reds, nothing special at the present moment. In terms of the win against the Stormers and the draw with the Sharks, they've been lucky. I think it was luck playing a part and just the general errors creeping in from the opposition side. Jaguars, a good scrumming team, good pack of forwards, can be dangerous in open play. We have seen them score some really, really good points, from open play. If the Jaguars can get their discipline under control, I mean, we say this week in and week out, if the Jaguars work on their discipline and actually produce a good, clean game, they can be dangerous, and they have proven that they can. They have put away some better teams than the Waratahs before. So, I mean, the Waratahs, we expect to come through on this one 3-5. However, if the Jaguars show up on the day and have a good game, it could go their way too.
Yeah. So those are our previews for the week. Yeah, hopefully your Subaru picks go better than mine did last weekend. Maybe well, 4 out of 7 was not a good weekend for me. But yeah, so I think that's where we're going to wrap it up this week. Enjoy the rugby, like the video, subscribe to the channel, and yeah, we'll see you next week with our analysis of the weekend's games.
Yeah, like, comment, and subscribe. Thank you so much.